Blog Talk Radio.
Hey guys, January the 10th, 2014. Welcome to the show. Hope the audio's good. We're going to have a great show today. We got cut off from Michael yesterday, a little before the show was over. He's going to call back in if he's any way possible that he can today. We're going to continue that conversation. Michael.
Hello, JC. How are you, my friend?
I'm doing fine, Michael. I apologize. We got cut off yesterday, right in the middle of our conversation. I looked for your number, and I couldn't see it back up there, and I didn't know if you had to get off the line or just got cut off.
Well, we had communication spikes everywhere yesterday, and they are continuing today.
They are. What, now, from our satellites, or is that what you're...
Yeah, our SATCOM satellite communications are quite blinky, so they switch to the wide spectrum, so they could hop frequencies to avoid some of those dead bands, but it's still causing an effect.
Well, I'm still seeing instruments such as the GOES and things like that that are... don't seem to be normal at all. Some of our satellite readings from the GOES satellites don't seem normal at all. I don't know if they were damaged or just turned down. Michael, we talked about that yesterday, but it's not normal readings.
No, they said sometimes when something can damage these satellites, they will set them in a minimal mode or sleep mode, if you will.
Right.
And so further components won't get damaged because these devices are radiation sensitive, and we did have quite a bit of it yesterday, and today, and it will linger for about the next day or so.
Back in 2011, we had an X flare, and Stereo B has not been clear since. Stereo A, you can still get a picture, but B took the blast head on, and it
lost the lens.
Surprised some of the optics.
Yep, it sure did. But they have the other one, so on the public side, they can still see it. Like I said before, it does a lot more than people know because it has other optics on there where they actually see things. I think one of the technologies people always miss is this. Sonar does not use optics. So if you think in the lines of sonar, they pick up a lot of imagery from sonar-type devices also, which allows you to see a lot more. Certainly a cell phone is used with that same principle so that they can actually determine what's going on where within a 3,000 foot radius of any cell phone, because all of them collectively act as a sonar and they compensate for each other. So I don't know if people know that or not.
With this Wi-Fi and things like that, even the new desktop computers you're buying are Wi-Fi.
Mm-hmm.
They want you, and they're changing the modems to Wi-Fi. You used to could kind of have an option of a wired, but now they want this circuitry everywhere, beaming through the air.
Yeah. Well, they can manage everything and change the frequency itself on the fly, based on what they need it for. What they're actually doing is positioning all electronic devices, to run from a central controlling computer. And that computer does exist right now, and it could effectively run every single electronic device in the world, not to mention forecast thoughts and process data so fast, it's just incredible. You know, by people's standards, that would be incredible, but that's what they're doing. Jesse, like I had said once before on Pastor Paul's show, they only admit to those things they can optically prove, which means if people cannot see it on their instruments and telescopes and so forth, they're not going to tell the true nature of anything. They will confirm what people can already see to maintain a type of superiority over that knowledge. But if you can't see it, they're not going to say anything about it. Somewhat like that that comet, and I'm still waiting for that story to come out, that almost hit us in December, December 17th, that no one said anything about. They didn't classify it or anything, and probably because it has sister objects with it. There was one that did pass. That was a prelude to the, this one sat behind the one that passed December 11th. It was a medium-sized one that passed just December 11th. Well, it's a larger one was right behind it. Now, this,
I was listening to Brother Paul's show when you called in, I think, Michael, about that.
Yeah, you can find the one December 11th because amateur astronomers found it. Right. And so after amateur astronomers find it, what they do is normally they classify it and dig out the records. If no amateur astronomer can find it or see it, because some objects you simply can't see,
right.
they won't say anything about it until about months later. It'll likely come out if anyone has actually seen it through an infrared telescope and so forth. But
right.
If not, they're going to suppress it just like they did all the others.
Right.
But I
don't doubt that a bit.
This object that's supposed to impact Mars, they are very aware of it. I think, Jesse, I'm forced to tell you this.
Okay.
Everybody's familiar with these zombie things that were coming out, and lots of people have theories. Even certain people who have held government seats have theories on this zombie issue.
Right.
But here's a real issue. Our neurological systems cannot function in a damaged magnetosphere. They can't. The neurological connections will begin to break down.
Well, our body is electrochemical anyway, isn't it? I mean,
right.
You know, moisture, electricity and moisture.
That's right. And then our neurological system is affected by magnets greatly. And they found this out. The Russians actually discovered this with a tragedy that happened to a few of their pilots. Once the neurological connections are broken, they don't grow back. In essence, these people they went back to their primordial states with high aggression factors. Now, the zombie story actually came about after some finds and some serious consideration of not only the Russian casualties, but that these objects that are passing Earth are getting closer and closer. Some of these objects are extremely magnetic, somewhat like Mercury, a big magnetic chunk of rock. And if it passes the Earth, it will certainly disrupt the magnetosphere. If it does that, certain portions of the Earth, once it affects those certain portions and takes the Earth's natural magnetic field away from those areas, those people in those areas will lose their neurological connections. They will, and it happens within minutes. This is not a long process. It happens within minutes. Jesse, I can give you one nugget here that people will entertain a changing of the sky color in the evenings, and a lot of people will see this, you know, when they get off work and so forth. But following that represents a great instability in the crust of the Earth. And by the way, there is a super volcano right off the East Coast. Jesse, you may be aware of this, but there's a super volcano right off the East Coast underneath the ocean floor.
Well, I don't know much about that. I do know of that meteor impact that was off Chesapeake Bay. But I don't know about that volcano. I may have read about it, Michael, but I got through so much information. Where is it located?
Well, it stretches as far inland as it goes from Georgia, parts of Georgia, all the way up to Pennsylvania, which just so happens to be Region 3 again. But that's how far it goes, and it goes way out to sea. That's just like a small lip of it, but it goes way out to sea.
That's the eastern border of the Appalachians.
Yes, 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 it is, and it's also. Region 3 is a very significant region. Of course, like I told you guys before, they're moving all headquarters from the East Coast to somewhere else. There will be an excuse in this water contamination deal.
Yeah.
Well, probably, now, in my opinion, there will be some issues from it, but it will likely be contained. What will not be contained is the disease that follows it. And I say this because a lot of vaccine, refrigerated vaccine vehicles are in the mountains of West Virginia everywhere. They're guarded by FEMA and guarded by National Guard soldiers. No one can get close to them, but they are refrigerated trucks everywhere in West Virginia. These things supposedly hold vaccines, but we don't know what they hold. And if this water containment issue could spawn evacuations by way of disease, and that's why they deployed
the guard, didn't
bio they? Teams. Well, they deployed bio teams and FEMA. The bio teams are coming with FEMA.
That's the first thing, Michael, when I saw that report. I was actually this morning before daylight, I was listening to the BBC radio, and they were talking about this spill there. And, you know, they allowed it to go a day before they warned anyone. Nine counties that got into their water supply, they not only can they not drink it, they can't touch their skin.
Right. And the worst part about that is, and you know what, that's not even the worst part. The worst part to me is this. It's because most of them, if you listen to the media, they're going to claim it's something unknown. In other words, it's a brand new chemical, so they don't have enough data to say whether it's bad or not, you know, whether it's lethal or not, or will it cause long-term effects. Anytime they do this, disease normally follows. And there are containment efforts that will follow should any disease break out in Region 3. The containment systems are already in place. Now they have an excuse to move. Now they have an excuse to move the remaining materials that they need to Region 3 by way of this spill. They know all too well what they're doing.
They're saying they can't remove that. It's almost floating on the water, but they can't remove it.
It's dissolving. And that's why the bio teams are there, because they don't know if it a lot of times when they have chemical spills with these new chemicals, because they're environmentally friendly, they actually absorb into organic material and change its DNA or its composition in some way, which can spawn something brand new. If that happens, you're looking at some type of evacuation, because it's only a matter of time before it saturates the lands around it. Animals become sick. If a few of those animals get disease and it's passed to humans, then there's a real CDC problem. And it could be another reason why so many... Go ahead.
I was just saying that, you know, it's in the water. It came down the river, got into water treatment, and everything got into the drinking water, right? Now, it's not like when you see these boil water notices, you know, where the broken main or something like that, where once they fix it, you boil your water for a few days. Every line, every hot water heater, every filter is going to be contaminated. Nine counties without drinking water. They can't bathe. The National Guard is handing out bottled water there. Now, we went through that here in Katrina. The Guard came in. They were handing out water, things like we didn't have anything here as far as that. But
right.
As soon as the electricity was back on, we had to run the water for a little bit. They heavily chlorinated it and stuff like that. But it wasn't disease like this. They can't just turn this back on and let people start drinking out of it.
No, they can't. It's a brand-new element, and with most of the environmentally friendly elements that they use, the chemicals they use, they actually bond with organic material. If they have a press conference, I encourage anyone to look at it. And now, if the corporate owners of the water companies are too agreeable, and they do actually state that they have no clue as to the ending of anything, then they need to be careful. But I would advise anybody living in that area, and for those that are not, to take notes, because if it works, and this is just the way the industrial complex works, if this works, if people buy this one, they'll use it again. It'll be the first of many water catastrophes.
Well, yeah, I mean, people just don't realize that without water, you're not going to make it very long. It's almost to the point now to where you're talking about evacuation. Until they can fix this problem, you might as well evacuate, or you're going to be sitting there with the guard handing you a bottle of water and no way to take a bath, or you're talking about disease spread.
Right, because this morning they were speaking about evacuations. They were looking at scenarios where an evacuation could possibly take place. They have recoded their vessels not only for the oceans, not only for the radiation compensation in the atmosphere, but for very large electrical discharges. Because if any body of significant size comes into this solar system, we're going to see electrical discharges from one of these objects to the other. And there's already to our south a large magnetic ball about, it's a little bigger than Mercury, but it is not Mercury, and it is 100% magnetic, as far as they can tell right now. And you will not see that, out there until the effects begin to take place, and then they'll say, well, we discovered this magnetic ball, which is likely causing these influences, because they're going to announce something so terrible that it will seem hopeless to believe in anything on Earth.
Michael, is it this magnetic ball, is it visible to the human eye, or is it?
No.
It's a ball of energy.
In fact, Jesse, it is, although it's solid, it is so dark. It is so dark, it's just, it would be almost impossible for an amateur astronomer to pick it up.
I understand.
Due to its outside chemistry, if you look at it through infrared, it kind of melds in with the other infrared objects out there, so it may look like a blur, although it's closer than one would anticipate, than one would like it to be. And there are things like that lurking around. We're just in that area, in that time period, where we're about to face these things. Some of them will be announced. It will be scary. I'll just tell you right up front, it's going to be scary. Nations are a little nervous about these things because there's nothing they can do about it. Zero. They already blew objects out of the sky, like Elenin. If people look up, because you can't trust NASA, all you have to do is start reading the European Space Agency's publications, and you'll see what's other things that are happening. Because what we don't announce, someone else has already taken care of. The European Space Agency did, in fact, launch very large missiles at Elenin, and a lot of people don't know that either.
I knew it broke up. That's all they were saying, that it had broken apart. Just a debris field?
Yes.
Because it's trapped.
And then again, that's right, because it's still trapped in our solar system's pool. Because when you break an object up, right, although scientists will say as it loses mass, it also loses its pool.
That's right.
But it never made it out far enough to escape Jupiter, so it's going to be slingshot it right back around to us again. Once the JPL model
happen
with
Einstein's debris trail, Michael?
Yes, it can. Yes, it can.
Well, see, I did a video
yes,
about that. I said because it had broken apart, it lost its mass, and therefore a lot of the energy, the gravitational pull on a large object is tremendous. But when you break it apart, that's broken up also. And what happened was Einstein traveled. It was supposed to, after about 3 days, slow to about 2 million miles a day, but it maintained 3 million miles a day for a few more days because of that. Probably that magnetic pull was broken. I'm not sure, but that debris, we watched that debris trail and it was huge. The objects in it were huge when we were looking at close-ups when it came around the sun at perihelion. Tremendous size. You try to compare it right next to the sun, and it's almost, you're saying it can't be real. It cannot be that big, those pieces. And I was concerned because without that magnetic attraction and that gravitational pull or push, would it go back out into orbit? And from what you're saying, it's very, you know, we're just creating another inner solar system debris field. Hello, Michael, did we lose you? Guys, we may have lost him. I'm going to try to get him back on the phones. Hey, guys, we lost Michael right there. I have one more question. Michael, if you're there and you can call us back, I've got one more question. I think it's important. You may or may not can answer it. But I was just going to ask, and I'm sure everyone's thinking the same thing, has there been any kind of estimated arrival time for this magnetic object that we're talking about that could disrupt these magnetic fields? And if we can't get you back on today, we'll schedule that, but I'm sure that's the $100 million question right now, is do we know when we could see the effects of this object? Guys, that's the end of the show today. Like I said, I want to do a video on this QQ-47 asteroid. We'll take a look at that. But heads up, guys, be safe.